Good afternoon to everybody. So as Dr. Talukdar said, it's a small workshop on systems biology. And I'm going, so what do you mean by systems biology? So essentially, when you study biology, be it biochemistry, cell biology, you normally look at it as certain pathways driving responses or certain molecules playing important roles. So in systems biology, what one believes is no single molecule or pathway does anything on its own. It's all a kind of connectedness. There's a connectivity between molecules, they form functional networks, and it's those networks that actually drive biological behavior, if you want to call it that. And it's much like a very good analogy is people, right? So you're each an individual in your own right, but a lot of your functions are governed by the network that you are a part of at any given time. So currently you're a network of people who are participating in this workshop. You will show a certain kind of behavior, and that behavior will be either sit quietly or sleep quietly without snoring. But when you go out into your lab, you exhibit a different kind of behavior because you're part of a different network. When you go home, you're part of a different network. And in each of these networks, your relative importance varies, right? So in particular, say if you look at this particular network that we have now, if any of you go out, it doesn't affect the workshop because the workshop will continue. If I go out, this particular lecture is affected. So in that sense, I am a reasonably important person in the context of this network. But now when you're in your lab, I become completely irrelevant. Somebody else becomes important. Or when you're outside with a group of friends, there are certain friends who guide behavior of that group. So the relative importance of individuals or of any given individual in the network varies with the context. So you are a single person who can form different networks under different circumstances, and your relative importance in that network varies given what network you're a part of at that time. And that's exactly how proteins behave. So as you know, proteins also multitask. The initial puzzle of how come we only have 20 or 30,000 proteins, but yet we are such complex people, is resolved because each protein multitasks. And each protein also forms parts of networks, and these networks can vary with context. And the relative importance of that particular protein, functional importance, can vary in terms of the context of the network. Okay, so the simplest way to understand proteins is to understand how people behave. And that has become a new paradigm or a new understanding in biology. And that also becomes very, very important in terms of when you start thinking of drugs for diseases today. Because, you know, you may have learnt about this mutation causing that disease, that mutation causing that disease, but essentially they were oversimplifications. It's certain networks and network architecture that drives responses. And as you know, every time you guys form a group of friends, your behavior changes. The behavior as a group is different from the behavior of each of you as an isolated individual. And that behavior is called emergent properties, right? And by all biological behavior is emergent properties. Disease is an emergent property. So understanding how those emergent properties arise in the context of a disease, and understanding what the relative functional hierarchy of those proteins are in that context, is essentially key to the future of developing new therapeutic strategies for most of the diseases that we have today. But what I'm going to do today is not so much about, and that's really the goal of this particular center, which I'm part of, the Drug Discovery Research Center. This is something we started a couple of years ago. And the whole purpose of that center is to actually exploit these kinds of network-based strategies. And to understand networks and network behavior, you need a multidisciplinary unit. You need, of course, the experimental biologists. You need the computational wallahs. You need the mathematicians, and so on. And that's the, and that's basically what the center focuses on, is to integrate biology, chemistry, computational sciences, mathematics, to try and understand networks that drive certain diseases? And can you now, based on that understanding of networks, can you identify new strategies for treating the disease? But what I'm going to talk to you about today is ways of how you can look at disease, completely different ways that you have not anticipated so far. And I'm going to take an example of tuberculosis, right? So this is something we have been interested in for a few years. And I'm just going to talk to you about some of the approaches we are now adopting to study how this pathogen, this bacteria, infects the macrophages and stays in there for extended periods of time. So if a pathogen can survive in your body or in a cell of your body for a long period of time, it must be involved in crosstalk with the machinery of the cell, right? It must have mechanisms for engaging with the protein pathways and so on of the cell. And understanding that is one of the major challenges. And I'll just talk, we haven't completely succeeded yet, but I just thought I'll use this to give you a flavor of the kind of approaches you can use and give you a sense of sometimes how complex it is when you want to start looking at some of these things. Okay, just to give you a little background, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, as you know, is something that infects you through the lungs and infects the macrophages in the lung. And basically what it does, it goes and attaches itself through receptors on the surface of the macrophage, and this is then taken up through this process called phagocytosis. And once inside, it finds ways of preventing maturation of the phagocytic pathways and so on, and essentially finds ways of living in this cell for extended periods of time, years and so on. And that's not such a trivial job, because as you probably know, macrophage is one of the most potent of immune cells that you have. It's got very, very potent capabilities of clearing infections, stimulating immune responses and so on. But the fact that it can convert this very potent immune cell into a very servile and obedient niche for its own survival suggests that it can actually exert very strong influence on the macrophage, and it has ways of tuning down the functions, the antimicrobial functions of the macrophage. And that's something is of interest to us, trying to understand what is the dialogue with that the bacteria engages with the machinery of the macrophage and that allows it to control it and tame it into something very docile. So this is simply what I say, once the mycobacteria gets inside, the macrophage can potentially do many number of things in order to make life difficult for the mycobacteria. So one is it can block nutrients from it, or it can use machinery to degrade the mycobacteria, and of course inflammation and autophagy and a whole range of processes. But again, like I said, that the fact that it can actually survive means it can the mycobacteria has found a way to control all of these processes and basically shut them down. Yeah? So it's converting something very hostile, a very hostile cell, into a very friendly environment. Right? So one thing we know, I'm not going into the background, is that it actually exerts a very strong control on the metabolism of the host cell. I'm sure you're all familiar with the central carbon metabolism, which is essentially talking about glycolysis, the citric acid cycle, pentose phosphate pathway, and so on, right? And that's key for any cellular response, because anything that the cell does requires energy, okay? And it comes through the central carbon metabolism in terms of whether it's ATP or NAD, NADH, and so on. And one thing we had known from some of our earlier studies is that this is one area which actually mycobacteria controls and tunes the central carbon metabolism. So the idea was, how does it do it and what exactly is going on? That's the question we wanted to ask. So how do you do that? So what one could do is you can infect macrophages with mycobacteria and look at what it's doing to all the metabolic reactions of the cell and how they're being controlled at different time points after infection. So you're looking at different stages after infection. What is the kind of control that the mycobacteria is exerting on the host central carbon metabolism? But how do you figure that out? Just to cut a long story short, you can actually give it labeled glucose. So normally, you know, carbon of all the organic compounds an atomic mass of 12. You can take a carbon 13 isotope of carbon and label them. So that allows. So what happens is this glucose now has an extra. So glucose has 6 carbons. So if I replace all the carbons instead of carbon 12 with carbon 13, now it has an extra mass of 13. And you can track that as it's broken down in the various metabolic reactions and so on. So what you can do, or what we did is instead of the normal glucose which is there in the cultures, you feed with carbon 13 glucose, and you can track how that glucose now is used in the various metabolic reactions. So you'll get glucose 6-phosphate, fructose 6-phosphate, bisphosphate, dihydroxyacetone. So you can actually track, because in all cases it'll have an increase in mass. And you can use this technique called mass spectrometry, and you can track the generation of these intermediates. And importantly, if you actually do them, follow them as a function of time, at each of these stages of infection, so let's say you add glucose, and then 1 minute later, what is happening, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, and so on, you can actually get the rates of each and every reaction in the metabolic pathway, right? So once you get the rates, you know what the rate is in a normal cell, and you know how these rates are being influenced by the infection, right? And we did multiple strains. As you know, for every pathogen, there are different strains with different degrees of virulence and so on. So what we did is took multiple strains with multiple drug resistance and so on. And this looks messy, and it actually is a messy set of data. So if you actually, this is simply the 10 steps of glycolysis, and if you look at the rates of the reaction, how they change at various stages of infection. So this is a strain, this is what happens when you infect cell with a strain that is not virulent. It's a very harmless strain of mycobacteria. This, of course, it doesn't even infect very strongly. It actually immediately gets cleared out. And these are very strongly virulent strains. This is resistant to many, many drugs. This is resistant to some. So these are multiple drug resistant. This is also multiple drug resistant. This is drug sensitive and so on. So the idea was, you have 2 strains here which are not virulent strains, and you have 3 strains here that are virulent strains. So the idea was, when you track what is happening to the metabolic pathways or the metabolic reaction of the host cell, can you distinguish something unique that only the virulent strains of mycobacteria do, and the non-virulent strains do not? So in other words, can you actually identify what is that feature that characterizes the virulent trait of mycobacteria, right? And as you can see, this whole thing is very messy. There's nothing that actually says these 3 are similar and these 2 are different from these and so on. Each one is something in itself. And this is exactly what the problem of complexity of biological systems is that when you start looking for obvious patterns, you actually don't find any. And the reason being, all pathways are connected. So any change anywhere, if I change the reaction at one point in a network, it affects everywhere else, right? Because if I throw a stone here, he will react, that reaction will spread, and the entire network will actually change behavior, right? Somebody may throw a tomato from here, or somebody may shout from here. So, and that's the key in these networks. You disturb any segment or region of the network, that disturbance can spread over a large distance. And that's very different from the way we've been taught our biochemistry and so on, is that if I disrupt a pathway, it's only that pathway that's affected. That never happens. So, but at the same time, so there could have been 2 possibilities here. One is, there is really no method in what the mycobacteria does. Each strain does a completely different thing in terms of how it affects or impacts on the metabolic pathways. And there is no real method, and it doesn't matter virulent, virulent. Each strain is like its own person and behaves differently. Alternately, it's possible that there is something that is happening, that is, you can distinguish, that virulent strains are actually hitting certain parts in the pathway. But just exactly I said that because of this connectedness, they're exerting, if you look at patterns, in very different ways. So to look to see which of these possibilities is correct, So what we did, remember, when you do these when you do these tracking experiments with carbon 13 glucose, you can get the rate of every reaction, right? So this is essentially the central carbon metabolism pathway. This is glycolysis, giving you finally acetyl CoA in the mitochondria. This is the citric acid cycle. This is the pentose phosphate pathway. And this is the pathway where citrate comes out of the mitochondria and starts giving you lipids and fatty acids and cholesterol and so on, right? So you can actually track the rate of each of these reactions. And since you have that, you can now actually build a mathematical model that captures these effects, right? And basically, this model is based on differential equations. So you're actually capturing unit changes as a function of time. So you're getting a dynamic perspective on how the bacteria, each strain of bacteria, is impacting on the central carbon metabolism machinery of the host cell. And once you do that, the advantage of having a model, and since this is based entirely on experimental data, the model that you get is a very robust and a strong model. And the advantage of getting a strong model is now you can actually do what you call simulations. Because now you can do your in silico tweaking that, can I tweak any of these reactions to change the profile from what you see in one strain to that of another? And you can actually do that, and it turns out that you can actually tweak one or two reactions and change the profile that you see from a virulent strain to a non-virulent strain, or reverse it, and so on. And it turns out that all you really have to do is tweak two reactions, and you can interconvert the profile, right? You can convert any one profile to another. And what that suggests is that virulent microbacteria are in fact hitting only two points in the central carbon metabolism pathways, but because different virulent strains hit it to different degrees, one may have a threefold effect, one may have a fivefold effect, the way it is spread across a network can be different. And what are the two steps? It turns out one of the steps is actually increasing taking up of glucose by these macrophages. So what virulent bacteria do is they force the macrophage to take up glucose at faster rates. And we know now that the way they do it is by making sure the macrophage expresses these glucose transport proteins called, GLUT1 and 3. And that is important. And like I said here, different virulent strains do it with different kinetics and so on. And that's why you see the difference. But the fact is every virulent strain has to hit this process. And it turns out this is actually very important because this makes sure the cell survives. Because as the rate of glucose uptake is increased, the rate of ATP production by the glycolysis pathways increases, and that is critical for survival of the macrophage. Normally in an infection, if a macrophage is infected and it can't clear it, then what the macrophage does is tries to die, apoptosis, right? Because when it dies, then it's a defense response for us, because when the macrophage dies, apoptosis, it basically shrinks up and dies. Its integrity is intact, so it traps all the infectious bugs inside and does not allow them to escape. What the bacteria eventually want to do, they first want to settle in the macrophage, stabilize themselves, get good food, grow a little bit, and then eventually they want to induce death, but what they call necrotic death. In necrotic death, the macrophage will burst open, there'll be punctures in the membrane, so the bacteria can now come out and infect other tissues and other people and so on. So that's the competition that goes on. Macrophage wants to undergo programmed death or apoptosis, the bacteria has to prevent that. And the way it prevents that is making sure that the ATP production has increased. Because normally what the macrophage would do, if it can't deal, it would shut down its ATP production, and that would be a suicide process for the macrophage in terms of apoptotic death. So what the virulent bacteria do actually is prevent that and make sure the macrophage stays alive long enough for them to stabilize and so on, and eventually, of course, induce the necrotic form of death. The other thing that the bug also does is in the TCA cycle, you may recall that citrate is one of the key intermediates where you have acetyl-CoA condensing with oxaloacetate. And what the mycobacteria do is pump, make sure that the citrate is pumped out into the cytoplasm. The sub-aspects I'm not going to go into detail, don't worry about that. Because then once the citrate is in the cytoplasm, it breaks down to give you acetyl-CoA, and that becomes the substrate for cholesterol and lipid synthesis. And that is very critical for mycobacterial survival on two counts. I'll show you here. Okay, and that's true because the lipids that are made then accumulate as triglycerides, okay, fat, neutral fat, and they form balls of lipids called lipid bodies. Now, why is that so critical for mycobacteria? Because that's actually, these are the lipid bodies I'm showing you, and that's actually where the mycobacteria goes inside and sits. So this is a transmission electron micrograph. So this actually shows you a lipid body inside a macrophage infected. And here you see the bacteria sitting inside. And that is how they're actually protected. Once they're covered in a layer of fat, no macrophage antimicrobial pathway can get to the bacteria. So that is actually where the safe niche is. And once inside the macrophage, obviously the mycobacteria need food. Nutrient, and their nutrients or carbon source is actually fatty acids. So being surrounded in these lipid balls, they are safe, they're secure, and they're surrounded with rich food. So that's actually the secret of success of mycobacterial survival in the macrophage. And all of this is done, you know, you would think it's a very complicated process, but just recall, everything is done by this bug very elegantly and by simply tweaking only two reactions in this whole complex cascade, right? Just to highlight that. And that, I think, is important in biology. It's very simple, very elegant, and you know, really, really beautiful. This looks complex, but just by controlling one here and controlling here, it converts something very aggressive, very toxic cell for the mycobacteria into a very safe, harmless hideout. And that's really the elegance of how the bug actually adapts inside the macrophage, right? And this simply is the overall mechanism. I won't go into this, what the bug does, but essentially what it says is what the pathway, receptor it uses, everything we've basically mapped out. The bug eventually finds the lipid bodies here, yeah? And the beauty is once you understand this, you can, let me see what I have, okay. Once you understand this, you can now develop a new drug, a new strategy for treating against mycobacterium tuberculosis, right? So traditionally, when you want to treat an infection, you develop an antibiotic, right? You develop a molecule that will kill the bug. But also what happens is the bug comes back with drug resistance. And that's exactly what happens in mycobacteria. So we had an initial set of drugs for mycobacteria. Then they started getting drug resistant. Then they started getting multiple drug resistance, extreme drug resistance. And now you have infection where the bug is resistant to almost any drug you can throw at it, right? Totally drug resistant. And that is the problem. But here in this case, once you understand what is happening, you can actually now come up with a completely new strategy for treating the infection, that you don't touch the bug. You just touch the processes that the bug uses to exploit and adapt in the host cell, right? And that's exactly what we have done. So now we have actually developed a new, it's studies in progress, but a new drug-like molecule that actually hits this process and prevents these lipid bodies from forming. So once the lipid body don't form, the bugs are exposed and they can be killed by the macrophage. So rather than develop something that kills the bug, you just actually assist the host cell and shift the equilibrium so that the host cell can now is not co-opted by the bacteria and now can kill the bacteria, right? So that's so that drug that we're doing, we've developed, is now in trials and is getting close to phase one, and so far it's so good. But if something like that works, you've changed the game altogether, right? You've changed the way you can treat bugs. And that's one of the beauties of using systems-based approaches to understand. You can come up with radically or out-of-the-box approaches for treating diseases. And this is for an example for mycobacterium tuberculosis. So then taking it ahead, I mean, you know, obviously it's curious. So we only, in that study, we only looked at the central carbon metabolism pathway. What What does it do on a global scale? When you say metabolic reactions are being modulated, obviously you also imply that the proteins that control those reactions, the enzymes that control those reactions, are also being modulated, right? So what we wanted to do is get a more deeper understanding of the process. And what I mean by that is actually get a global idea of how the metabolites in the cell are changing and how they are relating to changes in the proteins or the enzymes that control those metabolic pathways. And the important thing again is, a lot of what you do in these have broader objectives. So I may be using this approach to study Mycobacterium tuberculosis, but once, and remember the thing about system biology, that's also the one, the beauty and challenge of it is, very often there are no set tools or techniques or approaches. You have to develop your own tools, you have to develop your own thought processes, and essentially it's your own jugaad. And that's, again, the fun of getting into some of these, yeah? So same thing here. So if you can actually understand the entire what we call, that is what my title said, the proteo-metabolic network, that is the metabolic pathways, where how the metabolites are changing and how the protein that control the reactions are changing. And if we can understand those regulations and quantify the changes, then you could in principle apply that to understand any disease, because almost any disease that you have is centered on the effects of metabolism. And certainly many of the prominent diseases that we have today, whether it's diabetes, obesity, cardiovascular disease, or any cancers, they're all in many ways centered on effects on the core metabolic pathways. So that's really a long-term idea. Use Mycobacterium because we're immediately interested in it. Develop these tools, and these tools are also, for instance, some of these tools we would even be applying to the current project that Dr. Talukdar talked about. So we would actually be interested in understanding how these changes happen in the liver or in the skeletal muscle or in the adipose, which are the tissues affected in diabetes, as the disease progresses, right? Okay, so the idea was, and again, we just took this panel, A, virulent strains. And you can see that a lot of differences in phenotypic properties of bacteria from the field. These are all clinical strain. Some infect more, grow faster, some don't grow as well, but they're all virulent. So this is phenotypic variability among the virulent strains of Mycobacteria. So essentially, again, I just to go back and simply summarize. So you have this, you take these macrophages, infect them with Mycobacteria, whatever strain you want, and analyze S6A at these time points after infection. And what are we analyzing for? One is, what are the changes at the level of protein? Okay, and these are quantitative changes. And for that, we use a technique called SWAT, sequential window acquisition of all theoretical fragments. I don't want to go into that, but essentially what it allows you to do is to go, it's like a digital map of the proteome of the cell, and you can quantify that, and you can look at what is happening to any subset of protein that you're interested in, okay? Yeah, and what is happening to those proteins in terms of quantitative changes at these different times after infection. So you can actually get a flow, a profile of how the protein levels are changing as a function of the duration of infection. And along the same time, we actually also look at what happens to the metabolites, yeah? And here we expanded the scale a bit because we looked at about 200 odd, 180 odd metabolites. Or what that happens, right? So we have this network, like I said, we have the complete metabolic pathway map, the proteins that control those reactions. And now what we're tracking is, what happens to those proteins in that map? How do they change? How do their levels change as a function of duration of infection? And how do the metabolite outputs change in the course of infection, right? This just gives you a summary, different strains, and you can see actually we find about 3,000 odd proteins that keep changing in these different infection times, and at different times, and you can see each strain actually produces its own unique effect. These are the different strains, and at 6 hours, 18 hours, and so on. But largely, whether it's an avirulent strain or a virulent strain, the majority of the effects are actually common. So here you have about 800 or something like that. This is a summary of all of these. So out of those 3,300 proteins that are affected, about 2,400 plus are commonly affected across all the strains, regardless of whether it's a virulent or an avirulent strain of bacteria, okay? So infection per se induces a common effect, and what virulence does, what virulence things are much more subtler effects involving a fewer number of proteins. So the dominant is just a response to infection, but there are very subtle effects through which virulent strains express themselves, and these are restrained. And what is important is those 3,000 proteins that you see that are affected are actually very tightly networked. Okay, they're all tightly connected to each other. So what I mean is, if I take this group and I find that some of you are very tightly connected to each other, means that you guys are very close friends in this group. So in this group, you will have some of you who are very close, and then that's a close is you know, not as close to others and so on. So that is the connectedness in this group. And since you find that this group is well connected, it says they're functionally related. Okay. More important is, of course, this is okay. This is actually more important. There are only about 121 proteins that are differentially affected in virulent strains. So it's a very small effect, but the small effect is enough to give you a virulence-related outcome. You only need one guy with a gun to terrorize all of you. You know, although you may be 100 sitting here or 50 sitting here, and that's. But interestingly, they are also well connected, so they are also functionally linked. So there's some kind of functional coordination in terms of the proteins that are affected as a consequence of infection, and particularly those proteins that represent the consequences of a virulent infection. Okay. Similarly, if you look at metabolites, like I said, we'll monitor 180 metabolites. And you can get all kinds of, you know, you can identify all the different pathways that are affected. And some of these are much more important, like protein biosynthesis, urea cycle, and so on. And this is how they're, you know, affected as a function of infection time. But more importantly, so if you now look at the metabolic pathways, it's like a huge global map, right? These are all just a small snapshot of the different metabolic pathways in our cell. And again, we thought, to, as a starting point, let's go back to our favorite central carbon metabolic pathway. And this essentially shows you the metabolic reactions that are affected, the metabolites that are affected, and these are the proteins that are affected, right? And okay, this is what I call a proteo-metabolic network, because it is talking about all the metabolite pathways. I hope you recognize this is the glycolytic pathway, citric acid cycle, pentose phosphate, and so on. And these are the metabolites in blue. The red are those reactions that are accelerated. Black are those that are not. So you can actually now map what is happening in response to given infection in this metabolic map in terms of the protein, the reaction rates, and everything, right? It's a complete descriptor of what happens, and you're representing quantitative changes. So red means this particular metabolite is increased in this particular situation, and so on. And what this shows is exactly that kind of a map, which is depicting the effects at different times post-infection, right? And this is an avirulent strain. So you can see, let's say if green is a reaction that is slowed down, red is accelerated, you can see at different times post-infection, you can see how the impact on this pathway varies as a function of infection time, right? And this is what is happening in response to infection with an avirulent strain. And this is exactly the same thing in response to infection with a virulent strain. Now you can start seeing differences. Again, one is the pattern, you know, the impact changes as a function of infection time. But even between the two, the avirulent and virulent, you can start seeing differences. So for instance, look at this region. There's not much of an impact on this region, avirulent strain. But the moment you have a virulent strain, this region is impacted. And that flows and so on. And different regions get impacted and so on. So you actually have a trace, a dynamic trace of how, you know, a set of pathways is being perturbed in response to either a virulent or an avirulent infection to begin with, and how those effects are diversifying as the infection progresses over a fixed period of time, right? And this is actually a challenge, and we're still struggling with this, trying to solve it, because you can see it's very, very complex. What I've just showed you is one pathway. If you go back, there are hundreds of such modules like this, and this pathway that I talked about is only here. And you can see, so understanding it in a global context is a huge challenge, and we're still trying to develop methods to look at these at a more broader level. But I can tell you our goal is to understand how information flow is perturbed, right? So if I'm communicating, or if Dr. Talukdar is communicating to the students and faculty of the IASST, he will use a certain chain of communication. And if there is a perturbation, the way that information flows through the IASST staff and faculty and so on will vary. And sometimes that can have good effects, sometimes that can have bad effects. Somebody wants to add mirch masala and make it a spicy rumor, it'll have a different outcome altogether, right? And essentially that's what you're looking at when you talk about these pathways. You're looking at how information, biochemical information, is flowing through these networks. And in a disease condition, that flow, or that flux as we call it, is perturbed or is distinct from what it is in a homeostatic state. So and that's one of our goals. I'm sorry, I'm going the other way. Yeah, and that's one of our goals of how to integrate this proteome and this metabolite data is to actually calculate, use mathematics now, intense mathematics, to look at how flux and flux flows are perturbed, and what we want to identify eventually. And for some of these tools, we have actually developed some of these early versions, is to understand what causes the perturbation. So like I said, Dr. Talukdar is trying to communicate to his staff, and one of the intermediates is going to add mirch masala, and the nature of the information communication changes. So that's like, say, a disease situation, right? So here also you want to identify, we're calling them choke points here, what are these choke points that are actually causing a disturbance in flow of information, right? And at some of these types, we can actually identify that. Because then if you identify those choke points, you know how to correct it and perhaps restore a homeostatic state, right? And in principle, if that works here, it can then work for any other chronic disease, or at least you can think of applying it to any other chronic disease, be it something like cancer or diabetes and so on. So that's one of the reasons we're looking into this. But as you can see, it's not an easy challenge, because we have perturbations at each of the time points. But the next thing we have to do is actually convert that into a dynamic map. You have to connect the different time points so that now you have actually a time map of disease progression, and translate that into a network like this. And then now identify who are the guys who are actually driving information, the perturbed information flow across this network now. Remember, this is a completely different network. You're talking a network that captures the time-dependent development of disease. So if you can now find out who are the drivers across this network, can you then stop progression of disease? And obviously, this becomes important in our chronic diseases, be it diabetes, cancer, and so on. So that's the kind of tools we're trying to develop. We're nowhere there yet. It's still 99% dream, 1% data. But hopefully, slowly, the ratio will keep changing with time. And obviously, I don't do the work. These are all the people who do the work. Ajay, Shilpa, these are all the experimental wallahs. Mukul is a mass spec guy. Basirat is mass spec. And Saqib did the metabolomics. Samrat, Rajat, and Ankur, Rajat you will see tomorrow, are the guys who do the maths part. And I just loaf around and, you know, act like boss. Yeah. And of course, funded by the Department of Biotechnology. Thank you so much.